Hello, everyone. My name is Rob Garmaze. I head up the AI research team here at Infotech, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to our ongoing series on the use cases that are driving AI. Today, we're really pleased to be joined by the folks at Bloomfire. We've got Ryan Manoogian, SVP of Sales, Dan Stradman, Chief Marketing Officer, and Bobby Schreiber, Director of Sales Engineering. Welcome to you all.
Thank you, Rob.
And also pleased to be joined by my friend and colleague, Tisha, who's going to be helping me with some of the Q&A here. But let's get started just with a quick review of your value prop. If you could take us through what Bloomfire is, and in particular, how are you using AI to provide value to your clients?
Yeah, thanks, Rob. Happy to take that on. Bloomfire is a Bloomfire is a purpose-built knowledge management platform. We've been in the space as a bespoke solution for a little over a decade, and we serve 16 of the Fortune 100, and at the end of the day, are very purpose-built for the Global 2000. What we do is help raise the collective capabilities of employees in the enterprise to operate with a veteran mentality. They know the information they need to find answers fast and deliver solutions to their respective business units. They can operate from a central position of confidence with the content that they interact with. And we can provide that in a point solution, business line by business line, without losing the expertise of knowledge across the enterprise with an interconnected network of knowledge platform that brings the ability to get rot of knowledge out of a business, redundant, out of date, and trivial information, and allow for the individual to focus on the information that they need at the moment of time where that interaction really matters. Maybe it's a customer support member who's trying to solve a ticket, or an internal strategic member trying to make a better future decision on data. We all have knowledge at our fingertips, and Bloomfire makes it easier to access that knowledge.
Sounds wonderful. We do see quite a few knowledge management employee experience solutions in the market. What makes Bloomfire special?
Yeah, so the simple answer is it's all we do. It's 100% of our platform's focus, product focus, and team's focus. And having done that for over a decade for a lot of organizations, we've learned not just the technology components that are necessary to get knowledge appropriately captured, but also the service and delivery arm necessary to create the change management processes that make it a sustainable, adopted solution across the enterprise. We like to say it spreads like wildfire, but it really just comes down to the fact that it's an easy, familiar experience, whether it be a Google-like search, Amazon-like filtering, or overlaid with incredible generative and conversational AI capabilities. We just make knowledge work and are built for the end user to access and find knowledge really swiftly. And so we're very well integrated and very easy to configure to the needs of the business unit itself.
Sorry, I have this pun going. It spreads not just like wildfire, but like Bloomfire.
There you go.
That's my contribution for today. What kind of, when we talk about the need for knowledge across the organization, there's everything from, I want to know about my vacation policy or what's in my bank, to I want, detailed research on maybe a very technical topic. I'm even speaking from an infotech perspective. Where do you guys specialize and how broad do you offer your solution?
Yeah, Rob. So I'll take this one. I think the way to picture it is we really do specialize in enterprise knowledge management. And there's an applicability to our platform and our implementation that makes it scalable. So we certainly see and have many clients who are using this as a solve across all types of data, across all types of teams in an enterprise. What I would say is, especially in our kind of Fortune 500 clients, which is a big piece of our business, a lot of times it'll start off with a specific use case. So it will start off and say, we need a knowledge management solution for our customer support function. And so that becomes that first leg of the stool, so to speak, in the overarching knowledge management. Another primary use case we see a lot of is for research and development teams or research and insights teams in marketing that we have a lot of expertise in those. My own career has been built and working in that industry. And so a lot of knowledge there, and then sales enablement as well. So a lot of times it will start in a very particular use case and then bridge up to, okay, help us solve our enterprise knowledge management needs as well.
And do you skew towards larger clients? I hear you say Fortune 100. Is it for clients of all sizes, all industries?
We have solutions that can work across industries. I think primarily where we've seen the biggest, broadest kind of enterprise success is with those companies that are in the Global 2000.
Fair enough. In terms of what's under the hood here, what kind of models are you using? Are you using any of the popular LLMs that we keep hearing about? Or is this all proprietary stuff that's powering Bloomfire?
Bobby, you want to take that one or I can?
Yeah, it's a combination of both. So historically, we've built in a lot of what I would consider to be our legacy AI. So that's going to be a lot of the opportunities for us to do our deep indexing and just the way that we're able to process that information. But we have leaned into generative AI as well and are leveraging a large language model. Right now, we're using Azure's OpenAI, and that's really given us some really great innovation in terms of what we can do from both a search perspective, asking a question and getting a response that's generated directly from the information in our environment, as well as assisting in content creation. So assisting in getting summarizations of information, listing key takeaways, or even augmenting existing content by making adjustments to things like tone or length. So areas where we see generative AI be really powerful in our customers' hands. And I think this is just the beginning of us, and we want to continue to build and scale from there.
Very cool. Again, when I think of knowledge management, you could think very broadly. It's not just folks within the organization. It might be folks external to the organization. You serving external constituents as well?
Absolutely.
Short answer.
Yeah. Sorry, Ryan.
I was going to say, no, you're good. Short answer, yes. We provide at scale a personalized experience for logged in users. We find a lot of times those logged in users are business partners or managing external relationships that might need access to content that enables for market development or collective support of a customer. We're also finding that relationships are using a logged out experience and capturing the knowledge that they're already using Bloomfire to sustain and deliver to their staff into external self-service motions. So the beautiful thing about Bloomfire is the knowledge can be captured and curated once, and then based off of the audience you're trying to point that to, can be delivered without additional maintenance or burden to manage that direction of content. So both internal, external logged in or external logged out experiences are deployed across our platform today.
Fantastic. As you're speaking, I can imagine use cases even for InfoTech proper, like let alone our own employees, but our clients wanting to understand maybe even what we're learning about the AI landscape, that could well be a use case for us.
Absolutely.
I know you've prepared a demo. If now's a good time. Atisha, any questions, by the way, before we launch into the product demo or?
No, let's launch into the product demo.
Let's see. Let's see what you've prepared for us.
Perfect. Well, let me go ahead and get this pulled up, and we can take a quick look. One of the things when you are partnering with Bloomfire and you go through our onboarding and implementation is we're really going to style a community so that it's aligned with your needs. It's going to look like a familiar place to your users and really resonate with them by having all the right proper branding, colors, and logos, as well as full customization of what this whole center section is going to look like. And the intent there is that we're going to have very actionable items for someone when they first log into the environment. So, as we kind of talked about just a moment ago, we do span across multiple use cases, whether that's customer support, general knowledge share across the enterprise like we see here, or even those research and insights team to kind of look at our big three buckets. But within all of these, we brought forward the same technology, leveraging a lot of the artificial intelligence in various ways to ensure that no matter what that user needs, they're able to connect with that very, very quickly. So when we look at things from a customer support standpoint using our traditional search, this is a deep index search experience. So our system is automatically indexing every piece of content that gets uploaded to Bloomfire so that we can read every word and character and search against that instead of having to rely on just surface level titles and tags. So for example, if in a customer support scenario, I'm on the phones and someone is talking to me about an error code they're seeing, traditionally what I'm gonna do is come in here and search for error codes. We will pull back any content that matches with those terms. And in order to make sense of this and ensure we are delivering the most valuable or most relevant information first, we're pairing that deep indexing with a relevancy score where our algorithm is automatically ranking all of the content in here, allowing us to position that most relevant content first. Mm-hmm. So this is the experience that our users have had for, you know, the 12 plus years that we've been in business of being able to connect with that content using this logic behind the scenes and having generative AI just be able to pull these elements together, pointing them in the right direction. However, as we see generative AI coming in and recognize what the opportunity is there, we see that now our users could actually come and just ask a question directly to the AI in order to seek out a response. We have currently called this AI chat, and we'll see it's a slightly different search experience where it's now prompting me to ask a question. So let's take the same scenario. I have somebody that's calling in and asking about error codes. But instead of me having to just run a search, see if those words exist somewhere, and then choose between the options that were delivered back, I'm now able to simply say, well, what does error code 18 mean? And when we run this through, our generative AI is going to look across the body of work in this environment that I as a user have access to. So it's really going to respect a lot of the permissioning that we have brought forward here so that I'm not necessarily gaining access to content that's outside of what I should be able to access, and certainly not going beyond this environment. We're not looking at the internet or any other types of areas in order to try to produce a response. And we can see here that now this has given me good information about what error code 18 means, give me some information about what I could share with that customer about what they should do, and then really highlighting the resources or the sources that were leveraged to pull that info together. So should I need to continue on with this conversation, I may want to open up my full error codes post and now see everything about error code 18 and other error codes as well. So very when slick. We have, oh, sorry, go ahead.
No, I was saying that looks very slick.
It's great in this kind of scenario. And this is the you know, simple type of approach. I have a very pointed answer that I'm trying to receive, and I want to be able to quickly pull that back. And we found this to be very, very powerful in helping to connect those dots very quickly, especially in those customer support scenarios. But let's take a slightly different approach. Other times what we may be looking for is something that's not quite as black and white. There could be a number of different responses or a number of elements that are important for that user to understand. So for example, if I were coming in and I needed to quickly understand, well, what are some of the key pillars of Bloomfire security? In this, the same kind of process is taking place where generative AI is looking across the body of work in this environment. But you can see that now it's giving me more of a formatted type of approach. It wasn't a single element of our security that we wanted to pull back. It's all of these. But our customers are now taking this, and maybe I'm walking into an executive meeting, I can copy that and apply that to the deck that I'm working on, or if I'm working on an email and I need to convey that information. The fact that this is able to deliver information back in these different ways is really powerful in extending not only access to that information, but immediately being able to go and apply that to whatever work that you were doing. Furthermore, when we look at things from a research and insight standpoint, one of the common conversations that I'm having with customers is just, look, I need to quickly be able to ensure that my research is in front of all the people that need to be able to see it, but I want to make sure that they're connecting all the right information together and that they're truly understanding why this is valuable to us and what we needed to achieve with that. So in this capacity, I could come in and start to ask questions related to research in here, such as saying, maybe I am working on a project and I need to have a summary of Singapore's autonomous vehicle progress. You know, when we're able to take this kind of action and run this through, we will see that it is now giving me that summary and allowing me to, again, take this information and apply it to the work that I'm doing.
And so, sorry, this came from internal information or that you're sourcing information from the web at this point?
So all of this is internal information. So while we are leveraging OpenAI's, Azure's OpenAI to power this, we've really put in force a lot of controls. So we're turning down the temperature to reduce hallucinations. We're allowing this only to focus on the content in this particular environment. we're not necessarily combining data from other users or other elements here in order to make any adjustments. So this is the early phase of this approach, and something that we did in a very controlled manner intentionally, allowing us to really make sure that, number one, this is accurate, and that's going to be paramount for us, that it is secure as every other element of our platform, and that it respects all the same privacy controls that we know we need to enforce. Mm-hmm. We will continue to build on this and iterate, and we already have a lot of great ideas that are going to be coming out this year. But we tried to really prove this out in that very controlled way, where the AI is not trying to be pleasing. If I'm asking it for information and it's not in this environment, it's not going to try to formulate a response. It just lets me know, hey, I don't have any information on that topic. So in that way, we try to really get more confidence in our users that when they leverage this, they're getting those accurate responses. And then again, I think we can continue to build on this and do more creative things over time. Now, one of the other really interesting things that we can do in this capacity is start to look at the piece of content that was pulled back. And I think this is just another area where now I can look at this content and maybe this is exactly the research that I needed to see. That's 70 pages long. And maybe I have some additional information that I need to extract from this, and I'm trying to figure out a better way that I can connect with this content. I have the opportunity now to use this same experience, but I can point a question just at this body of work instead of at the entire community. And now I'm just narrowing in my focus in terms of where I want this to pull information from. So I may be looking for a comparison of the United States against Singapore and their progress, and we're able to run this through and allow it to extract that exact information. Here's what the United States is great at. Here's what they're focused on. Here's where Singapore has a strong focus. Really great, meaningful information that I certainly could have sourced myself. But as we try to figure out how can we leverage this technology to just impact or empower that end user a little bit further, this is where we're at with it, is really being able to help them get easy access to that exact detail. So this is our search experience. And, you know, again, this is the generative AI where I'm more question-based, getting answers, not just getting lists of content that may or may not contain exactly what I need. But the second area that I wanted to bring forward is just related to our content creation. Now, this is a good example where we can see this author gave me key insights and summaries and other things that we know are valuable to go along with the content, often referred to as just context to go along with our content. So when somebody else lands on this, they're not always meant with that really dense documentation. The challenge is it's just time consuming to create that. So even if I am the author of this and know it very intimately, creating those summaries or extracting those key insights is something that sometimes does take more time than we'd like it to. So with Bloomfire, what we can instead do is allow that same author to come in here and create content. We have a really positive editing experience, a WYSIWYG style editor with a whole host of editing options allowing me to build content in Bloomfire. But let's say I'm importing something from somewhere else. I'm able to pull this in from wherever it may live, integrations with other file storage solutions, but I'll just use my own hard drive in this instance. And if we wanted to take this piece of content as an example, this happens to be a PDF. When we upload it, we will begin processing it, ensuring we can render it in our document viewer, but also completing the deep indexing. That's still a core element of our platform, even with generative AI in place, and that all happens automatically. But once we have this in place, if we wanted to take additional action and get some of those summaries or key insights, that's where we can now leverage what we're calling Author Assist. And it's given me a number of different options. We're analyzing how long the content is and making suggestions. So if I wanted summarization, I can do that in various levels of detail, depending on who my target audience is for this. So maybe I just need a simple summary here to begin. When we submit this, we'll run that through our generative AI, allowing us to create that nice summary. And perhaps I want to simply insert that as a primer. But if I also wanted to come back and pull in those key insights or those key takeaways, again, we can determine how many points we'd like to focus on. Maybe this time we want 5. And when we submit this, it's going to give me that nice formatted list of 5 different takeaways that we want to bring forward. At the very least, this is the starting point for that author to now come in and fill in the blanks. Oh, I maybe want to elaborate further on this topic, or I wanted to shed a little bit more light here or there. It kind of reminds me of back in the days when we were in school and you're starting that book report, getting those first words on screen or on the page were the hardest part. This is really going to jumpstart that. But even when we do have content that exists, whether it is one of these elements here or something that we may have already produced, Our author assist has also given me the opportunity to augment things, perhaps expanding on a singular insight. So if I had one of these takeaways and I think that that's great, but I want to build upon it, generative AI can help me to expand on that again in different levels of detail. Or perhaps I already have summarizations or other bodies of work that are just a bit too long. I need to reformat this for the next project that I'm doing or to again fit into a presentation that I may be working on. I'm able to shorten this by various lengths so that existing content can now be condensed. My jargon-rich content can easily be smoothed out so I can make that more palatable to a broader audience by running it through generative AI and making sure that everybody can really understand what they've got in front of them. And my customer support teams love tone adjustment. I may have a message that I need to get out that at times should be more professional and other times more empathetic. And all of this is the area where we see generative AI being really, really effective at easily pulling this forward and not putting the burden on the author or the content creator to do so. Once we have all these elements in place, then we can move forward with publishing this like we would in our standard process. But we're really excited about the opportunity this provides because through our conversations with our customers over the year, this has just always been an area where we recognize this importance, but we want to speed up the time and ensure the accuracy is there. And that's what generative AI has been able to do, is bring all these elements together and really just give that end user the opportunity to perform at a very high level, even if they're not the most confident writer.
And I have to say, it looks like a pretty good summary right off the hop that you had. It didn't take very long to produce it.
Absolutely. And, you know, again, we've already started to expand on this. So we're looking at how long of content we should be able to absorb, you know, how deep should we go with these different summaries, and trying to provide more options to our users so that we can get something that's really compelling and, again, really hits on the key points that they're wanting to highlight. So very exciting stuff, a lot of very positive feedback from our early adopters, and something that we're really excited to continue to build on because, again, I believe that we're just in the infancy both of generative AI as a whole, but especially in our Bloomfire solution. Mm-hmm. So those are the key elements to bring forward. Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No worries. I had a question. Thank you so much for giving us a great demo. But I had a question on the different forms of files that your generative AI can read. So an example here is at Infotech, we do a lot of work with the PPT files and Excel files. So I was wondering if your generative AI assistant has any capabilities with working with information on slide format files, whether that's on Google Slides or on PowerPoint slides, or if it even has capabilities to analyze information on Excel, for example, as well?
Yeah, great question. It absolutely can do the things that you've described. So, you know, when we look at our document viewer, we're currently accepting over 29 different file types. So just in general, our deep indexing capability is very broad and ensures that our customers are very rarely having to augment or transform their content before they bring it to Bloomfire. Mm-hmm. Our generative AI is still running against all of those text-based assets. So a lot of success in your PDFs, Word documents, you know, your kind of standard content, but absolutely PowerPoints can be brought forward, and we've created really great summarizations or key takeaways from those. Its understanding of the text is really what's important and less about the format that it takes on. I can even upload an audio or video file here. We will automatically transcribe that content, allowing us to search against the spoken word. So both pinpointing an exact moment that a phrase is spoken in a video through my deep index search, but also summarizing the content of that video using generative AI. All of these things are possible because of the way that we've built this technology so that it does become very flexible and therefore adoptable in various use cases across the enterprise of different types of situations or challenges people are trying to solve.
That's and that, again, speaks loudly to me because here we are doing videos like these where synopses would be really valuable.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. So, you know, this is really just expanding the art of what's possible with our customers and leveraging a lot of valuable information they already own, but making that now much more accessible both to their internal users, but also now able to convey that information more broadly if they wanted to have that external component we spoke about a moment ago.
Where do users go to log these questions? Do they come to the app? Can they do it within SharePoint, Slack, or what kind of flexibility do you have?
Yeah, so I think there's different ways to approach this. The majority of our users are going to come directly to the Bloomfire platform, whether they're accessing that on their desktop or they're pulling that up on their mobile phone or their tablet. We're fully mobile responsive, so we are on the go with a lot of our customers, some of them even working in the field and accessing their knowledge. that is going to be the traditional way that we see this, but we do have integrations with other platforms. Mm-hmm. So we can access Bloomfire content from platforms like a Slack or Microsoft Teams. Our integrations there are providing me both a search experience, but also just notification and awareness. So when there's new activity happening in Bloomfire, we can make sure that that's present in Slack or Teams using our bot. But when we talk about the generative AI right now, we're looking at that as the desktop experience. So that's where someone's coming in and being able to access it in the same way that I just demonstrated, sure. Clicking on that button and accessing it there. However, I do expect that we'll be able to extend that to other areas as time goes on and we get more comfortable with what the technology is doing.
And in terms of the content, are you duplicating content into the app? Are you accessing content directly in the SharePoint and other stores, or where does the content live?
So primarily content will live in Bloomfire, and we do assist our customers with that in the early stages of onboarding, where we will migrate any content they think is relevant for their Bloomfire instance. That way we do get all the deep indexing, the benefits of really everything we've discussed thus far. However, we do understand that for various reasons, content may need to reside in another system such as SharePoint, and there's a lot of validity behind that. So we have introduced what we're calling Enterprise Search, which is now allowing you to select the document libraries from SharePoint that you would like to make accessible in Bloomfire. So an API connection that is allowing for the data flow, but the physical file continues to reside in SharePoint. We update that feed on a 15-minute basis, so we have the most relevant information coming in. But once we've got access to it, it operates just like anything else that we're hosting. It's deep indexed, so it's searchable. My generative AI can run against it and allow me to ask questions of it. And it's giving me that same kind of very positive consumption experience.
Fantastic. It feels like you guys have thought of everything.
Well, we still got a lot of work to do. I think this is a very exciting area. And you know, where we're at right now, again, very positive feedback from both our existing customers as well as the prospects that we're speaking with. But it's just a huge amount of opportunity. And we've made some really interesting acquisitions and hires on our side to ensure we've got the right people behind the keyboards working on these problems. And we're really excited to see what 2024 and beyond brings, because, again, I think there's a lot that we can be doing.
Thank you so much for the demo. This is fantastic, so I really appreciate it.
Our pleasure.
Maybe back to the use case just for a sec, just because it's so broad. I'm trying to wrap my head around between clients and employees, between research and search, and just general knowledge. Is there kind of a dominant form of usage you're seeing, or is one starting to really light up for you, or are you really seeing, you know, activity across all of those?
I think we're, if I can answer, I think, Rob, we're seeing activity across all of those. And here's, you know, the history of Bloomfire. I think for a while, mid, you know, 20 teens, it was probably a bit more research and insights focused. Like that's kind of how it cut its teeth, and then started to go into the CS arena. And then that kind of bridged to broader knowledge management solves for, you know, mid-cap companies all the way up to, you know, the Fortune 500 companies. So, you know, and we can talk about it when we kind of get to the future vision as well, but I think one of the things that generative AI has opened up as a conversation point among executives at a lot of companies now is the value of knowledge. And it's, you know, whereas before it was a bit of the, like everybody kind of said, oh yeah, that's important. But then when the check came to actually do something about it, everybody got alligator arms and no one wanted to pay for it. And so it certainly raised, I think, the profile of knowledge management and enterprise knowledge management specifically to a broader swath of people who are in those executive ranks. And what that means is there's now, I think, this push to say, hey, we got to figure out a way to solve this and to take advantage of the proprietary knowledge and to protect the proprietary knowledge we have in ways that we hadn't maybe thought of in the past.
Mm-hmm. Makes sense. I'm curious, as you're pitching the value of that knowledge, what are you finding are the quantifiable benefits, or you know, how are you building that value case for your clients?
Brian, maybe it makes sense to bring up those two slides you've got on that just as a visual to talk the team through. I think there's some power there to kind of give both a broad example of, you know, kind of the returns we see from our average customer, and then call out maybe a specific use case example just to drive it home.
Yeah, great call out. If you can see the screen here, Bloomfire has Excellent. Yeah, we've had the opportunity of not only deploying solutions to the enterprise, but also with their support, have a number of customers that have done time and motion studies, surveys to their team. And we've, of course, interviewed and surveyed our customers from our own perspective. The benefit of that is a pretty strong correlation to a behavior pattern that we see across larger organizations and their benefit that they return. The first is we are seeing a pretty significant group of the audience, you know, roughly 80%, not have to search and hunt for information in various disparate sources. They know right where to go. They know if it's authentic and verified content. And then, as we just saw, they can interact with that content in more efficient ways. And they're consistently saving at least about an hour within a typical week of leveraging Bloomfire in day-to-day motions. We then have a subset of the team, usually about 25 to 30%. These are the content creators, team leads, members that set some of the charter of content strategy for the company, that have now a cockpit style operating position and the megaphone out to their audience within the business units they serve. And they're saving significant amounts of time, usually 3+ hours a week on average when you think about the position they get to operate from. And in general, as we see companies growing, people finding new roles, new companies joining the team and or new people joining the company in general, new employee onboarding or reskilling talent is a huge benefit to be able to have a home that you can start from and find that knowledge quickly. And so faster onboarding time is consistently leveraged as a main value point that we see customers benefit from. Specifically, we have customers measuring 15+% reduction in time to value in these customer facing roles where time is of the essence to get productivity out the door.
Fantastic. Those are some impressive numbers.
It's great to see. And not only that, but you get the anecdotal comments. And I'll start us here with a user quote. So this was a large organization, specifically a Fortune 20 consumer healthcare company that actually went through one of those A/B tests that I was talking about with a time and motion study. One of their users I'll start with stated, "I'd quit my job if I had to go back to the shared drive. I love Bloomfire." And although I don't want to threaten employment or have anybody, you know, go to that level, you know, the reality is the experience that we want is an empowering experience. It's not just I can find information, but I can do my job better. I can be better at my craft. And so the quantitative experience that we've derived from that is off here to the right. And it was a very mature existing solution. It was Confluence plus SharePoint plus homegrown tools versus Bloomfire. And what we found is time to locate job aids or time to resolve tasks was significantly more improved. But not only that, the intelligence of the platform helped. Even in an appropriate search, the first result and the first selection was the common outcome with Bloomfire. So our goal is not only the system can learn and deliver a great experience, but then that the interaction with the people will help it continuously drive relevant knowledge as the business continues to learn and grow, leveraging the platform.
Okay, pardon me for picking out the one number on the page that I don't like, but all this is so impressive. But 26 seconds, sure, that's really impressive given how broad, a knowledge universe exists. But can we even shrink that further?
I think we absolutely can. And so if we just pause and say, where did those 26 seconds come from? It was introducing a new technology to a new group and said, here you go, start to explore interacting with this. And within that motion, what we've done is we've been able to give them a position to operate and start from, but they're still looking for information in a wide open setting. And what we start to see in an uncontrolled setting, usually it's, I have a specific question for a specific problem, as opposed to sitting behind somebody saying, go through these successive actions and let me watch you do that process for the first time. And so what we find is, yes, Bloomfire is faster out of the gate, but then as individuals get familiar with the shortcuts, they use AI chat rather than just search, we can find the improvement of that experience to get even better. And then on top of that, with bigger deployments, this was a brand new one, we can integrate deeper into their technology stack where the information that we're pulling has more relevance, more context, and faster positions to get to that exact answer rather than just maybe the document itself.
And Rob, I recognize you've already...
I'll just add on and say for this example in particular, this is a customer that has not yet enabled the AI chat function. So this is actually using just the kind of index search. So they haven't, the 26 will go down as they enable the AI chat. So
yes, and I'm embarrassed. I mean, you've already cut it in a third or a quarter. So, you know, I have no doubt you'll continue to fractionalize the time there.
Thanks, Rob.
Something you mentioned sort of tweaked a thought, which is knowing when I should be doing a search versus AI chat. Is there kind of a confluence of those features over time, or you still find it best to keep those separate?
Yeah, I can speak to that, Rob. So that was actually purposeful for now. And there's a few reasons. One is a lot of customers and even prospects we're talking to aren't ready to switch AI on. It's just not, like, there's a lot of red tape. You know, we're working with teams and you know, it requires certain OKs from, you know, the IT director, the CIO. So we need to keep that optionality, so that base of customers or prospects that aren't quite ready for that yet still have the benefit of the deep index search and that. What we'll see is that the version you've seen today is actually evolving. We're bringing those slowly closer together as a change management exercise. So right now they're kind of in separate areas. They're going to start to get closer together in our next platform update. And then at some point, and I don't think it's actually in 2024, I think you'll start to see a convergence of those types of tools together. Again, it comes back to the fact that as a knowledge management platform, we can't be wrong. Like, we just can't. Like, that is the cost of doing business. So we need to take steps for our customer base to give them optionality so that when they ask a question, that they get the right answer every time, and that there are no hallucinations to the questions they're asking. And right now, that means separating that out.
Got it. That makes sense. What's involved? We talked a little bit about maybe some of the installation steps, syncing with the data sources and whatnot, but can you speak more holistically? What's involved in implementing and how big an effort does this represent for your clients?
Yeah, I can definitely jump in on that. So we offer a four-phase process that we have deemed the ignition sequence. So this is essentially a white glove customized approach that we handle with every one of our customers to help them achieve their goals. We begin with a planning phase. What are your goals? What are your KPIs? What are you trying to do? So that our success team can really understand that and ensure that we're aligning everything that we're going to work on towards those goals. We'll go into a configure phase where we're going to start to actually build out the environment. We want to get the right category structure and taxonomy in there. We want to understand synonyms they may be leveraging because we have a synonym engine and we can tie some of those terms together to improve the search experience. So a number of things that are just helping us to essentially assemble the structure or the underlying foundation. We then have our third phase, which is our migration phase. That's where we're porting over the content. So wherever that lives today, if we think that that is relevant and we want to bring that in, we're going to help them to get that into this environment and categorized with all the things that we just built out in that configure phase. That is also where we're helping them to go through a content audit. We want to remove the rot that we talked about previously, the redundant, outdated, and trivial information, so that we're getting a really clean environment to start with. And then finally, we'll move into phase four, which is where our launch phase. We don't just want to have this turned on and have somebody send an email saying, hey, there's a new platform. This is really about creating a lot of movement and excitement within the organization. So we'll partner with our customers to understand, what is your culture like? What is your team like? How do you like to operate? And we've seen everything from bingos and scavenger hunts to, you know, a variety of different ways that people have tried to bring this to life in their organization and get that excitement. Now, on a timeline perspective, we think about this as an accordion type of model. We'll expand or contract that depending on the willingness of our customer to move. I've seen deployments done in full scale in as little as 2 weeks. We've had some customers that have taken several months, and that's just because of how they operate and how much change management needs to occur on their side. But our team is prepped. We're ready to roll. So if somebody does need to accelerate that process, we can certainly do that with them and still have the same kind of outcomes and outputs that we're producing.
And even several months for cataloging all the knowledge in an organization, that does not sound very long to me at all.
Exactly right. So, I mean, I think that a lot of our customers are very realistic about that and understand what we're trying to do and how critical it is that we get this right. So let's put the right time and energy and effort into it so that we're doing this the right way. But we always remind everyone, look, this is not set in stone. Every single thing that we're going to do, we can update, change, or modify over time. So that, I think that puts a little bit of peace of mind in as well and it allows them to approach this but not overanalyze and therefore stall their process. We can get things moving and really help them out.
How big a services overlay is there here? Do I need sort of a professional service kind of knowledge transfer type part of the process, or right, do you have partners who help implement it, or is this all done kind of directly in a platform sort of way?
Yeah, I'll help get us started on that dialogue. Short answer, we've got all the resources in-house at Bloomfire necessary to make a successful deployment and transition, ranging from customer-facing engineers that help with data migration to change experts from a people and process standpoint. They're accompanying this broader initiative that Bobby's mentioned, which we call our ignition sequence. Now, the reality is the clientele that we work with will commonly bring in a global service provider or an existing representative that they might have inside or outside of their company that has been assisting with this effort at scale. And we're very used to working with those members and to Bobby's point, can give them key roles within the RACI matrix to determine what their responsibility is versus what ours is. But we have all the resources necessary to operate just with Bloomfire if necessary.
Fantastic. And deployment options, on-prem, SaaS, multiple options, or what kind of deployments do you do?
It's a SaaS cloud-based model, so not currently any on-prem, but we do get this stood up for our customers using our AWS is who we host with, and that's where we'll host their information and create their instance on.
And so apologies for the obvious risk question, but so now all my knowledge is SaaS-based. Any risk of this leaking out, or how do you mitigate that?
Everybody's concerned about it. And I think we've done a really great job of building this out in a very secure way. So, number one, we're a SOC 2 Type 2 certified organization. So we are getting those continuous audits from outside parties, as well as annual pen tests, where we're making sure that we're aware of the things that we weren't aware of. But we're encrypting all the content, both in transit and at rest, using the highest levels of encryption possible. We're ensuring that even though we do operate in a multi-tenant environment, that we've got the logical separators to not allow for any commingling of data or any risk of leaking across. And we've really pressure tested this. I think that some of our biggest footprints exist in both healthcare and financial services, where we see highly regulated industries that really come at us hard from a security posture. And we've been able to meet and beat all of their expectations and continue to produce a really great product. So while we understand those concerns, I think that we're more than adept at answering those questions, and that every time we've gotten in front of those CTOs and CIOs, we're able to provide the right information that makes them very comfortable about sharing even very sensitive info in our systems.
Yeah. And Rob, I'll piggyback on Bobby's answer. So I have the benefit of not only being a CMO here at Bloomfire, but also a former customer. And so as somebody who implemented Bloomfire at a Berkshire Hathaway owned chemical company, you can imagine the amount of security we were trying to put on, things, given the IT risk. So, no issues there. Bloomfire, from my experiences as a customer, had passed with flying colors on all those security concerns.
And once you say SOC 2, I think that alleviates a lot of the concerns off the top. So that's obviously a great place to start from. Any other risks that you see or that you mitigate for clients, things you're hearing from clients where you're able to help them kind of avoid some of the pitfalls?
Yeah. So, I think really we can look at that as a knowledge management side. We can look at it at an AI side too, right? As we all know, AI is something that's still at its infancy when it comes to kind of general market rollout. And so, Bobby, I think, hit on the high points. It's really about risk, risk tolerance, and we have some of the biggest financial services and healthcare companies in the world as customers. So we feel good about that. From the AI side, we are taking that conservative view, and ultimately we have to put security first. We have to put accuracy first, and we're developing this in a way that's meant to be knowledge worker accretive, right? There's a lot of worry out in the market, I think, among workers that, hey, you know, I'm worried that, you know, I'm going to lose my job because of this. I'm worried that, there's ethical dilemmas. I'm worried about privacy concerns. And so as we approach, whether it's an AI holistic kind of addition to the platform or a feature, we run our product development through that lens to make sure that we can be the right partner to our customers for AI. I think as you think about the future, you know, there's going to be cases where Bloomfire serves as that knowledge base that feeds into maybe a company-wide chatbot that they've developed, or we're the soup to nuts solution for knowledge management, including our AI interface and our platform. So that's the future that we're planning for. And, if we want to go deeper into depth on that, we can certainly talk through product vision as well.
Sure. I will come to that in a sec. I want to ask you first, rough and tough, how do you go about pricing for your services? And what is an average client looking at in terms of investment?
Yeah, keeping it simple, we are a kind of all-in cost. We're not charging for support. We're not charging for anything other than really providing access to a community of knowledge for the users that need access. So it ends up being a user-based model for looking at it bottoms up to provide that flexibility. I have a team, I have a group. I don't need my entire enterprise day one, but I want to lean into Bloomfire. We can build the model entirely around how many users we're supporting. When we're looking at an enterprise-wide solution through expansion or just right out of the gate, we then lean more towards a fixed price. We don't want people, counting up and down onesie, twosie, users. And we also want predictability for the enterprise. And so we will essentially build out a customized approach with the appropriate number of unique communities and users that we expect to, at a high watermark, be able to support, and then make sure that the infrastructure, scalability, and the support team is built around meeting the needs of that audience.
And can you give me a range? Let's say we're talking about a medium-sized organization, a couple of thousand employees, order of magnitude. What are we looking at?
Yeah, absolutely. So just kind of right off the cuff, a typical Bloomfire customer that's buying for their team or for a group is going to be looking at a price of $25 per user per month, which includes the necessary support from integrations or communities to operate within. So again, kind of keeps it simple. As we scale that up, of course, there are some economies of scale, and we get those as we get into the multi-thousand user level. And we sometimes see that drop down to $20 or less per user. It just kind of depends on the complexity behind the scenes. How many integrations are we doing? Is this externally facing? Are we embedding into a front-end website to power a search experience? So the layers can add, but I think it's a decent range. You do have some companies with us that are spending a few a few hundred thousand dollars. You have some companies that are spending a few million. Just kind of depends on how big a deployment and audience we're serving.
But I could see the business case. You're rough and tough, it's $20 to $25 per user per month. Rough and tough, you're saving each user what, an hour or two a week, it sounds like. So it doesn't take long for that to add up. Those economics make sense.
Well said.
Back to product vision. So it sounds like you've got a pretty expansive view of your market. What do you have in store, and how do you see this all, evolving as we go? What will the knowledge management category entail down the road?
Yeah, Rob, if you'll humor me, we have a few slides. You know, if a picture's worth 1,000 words, I think a slide's worth at least 150. So we can use this to kind of shape the discussion, but feel free to interject. So feel really good about our product vision. And so, this is really an encapsulation of where the market stands today. You know, if we were having this conversation back in 2001, I think we'd be talking about kind of, hey, there's knowledge management solution providers, there's, these enterprise data, enterprise search type providers, or, there's these kind of burgeoning AI tools. And I think what we saw happen across 2023, and it's certainly, I think, the future and beyond, is those are really starting to overlap. You've got enterprise search saying, well, we can solve knowledge management. You've got, you know, AI saying we can solve everything, to be honest. And you've got knowledge management that's saying, look, you know, we recognize, and Bobby spoke to this, like historically we, you know, people would come to the platform. I think as we think about our future, it's more of that interplay between integrations and we're, you know, having the data live naturally in different ways to interact. So our product vision really sits directly in the middle of that Venn diagram in terms of where we're trying to take it. And what that means somewhat, you know, is, you know, the future of knowledge management software, the future of knowledge management is about prioritization and automation. And we think of that across these 6S type of capabilities, the ability to scan data sets and information sets and recognize like, hey, this is something of importance, right? Obviously, you have to have great search. We've had great search for our entire history, but now you're going to layer on AI so that it's giving you answers quicker and you're able to connect those dots. Socializing really means if I've got information in the system, how do I automatically or automatedly get it to the right people at a point of inflection without that human needing to interact? So if Rob's interested in this topic, when new information comes on there, I know to serve this up to Rob right away because it's important. Select might be the hardest, right? That's where, you know, Ryan mentioned it earlier. Knowledge can get rot. It can be redundant. It can be outdated. It can be trivial, or it can be important. It can be need to be prioritized. And so the best knowledge management systems are going to have an automated way to say, this is important. This is rotted, if you would. Here's where your knowledge gaps are, and bring the appropriate people together to address those knowledge gaps or to address that rot or to celebrate that kind of good information. Signify is about measurement, right? Like, am I having an impact with the knowledge that I'm able to share, the SMEs I'm able to connect? And so that's metrics, analytics, those types of things. And lastly, synthesize. Bobby showed a bit of that in our AI author assist tool, right? The ability to take complex things, turn them into simpler things to make the knowledge more useful or more able to be categorized. And how we see that come together is really in this, right? Like this is ultimately about future of work. That's truly what we're building towards is this future of work, where Bloomfire can serve as that system interface to the organization, to the company stakeholders, to knowledge workers, and be able to reach into the appropriate places in the enterprise to find and to codify the right knowledge and information and make sure it's available. And that's, you know, the essence of where we're heading as a product and as a strategy. And so what that might look like down the road is depending on that user type, right? So whether it's a external customer who wants information, whether it's a, you know, kind of aligned CSR type person, maybe it's an executive, maybe it's a functional area head, they may be asking slightly different questions. They may be using different interfaces. So if it's that customer, they're using the web to ask the question. If it's the, you know, CSR, they might be working through Zendesk or something like that. Teams or maybe an AI bot, it's coming into our abilities and those successes and really saying, all right, I need to find that right info. How do I reach out into the organization, find the info, find the SME, the subject matter expert, and bring that back, you know, in a point of time to solve that problem. And so, you know, that's just a snapshot using these images of, I think, where we're headed as a company, and we're excited to build towards that. So
it's an exciting vision you have. Future of work, I think, says it extremely well.
Yeah.
Tisha, any final questions?
Yes, I had a couple, but I know we're out of time, so I'll just give it one. Thank you to everyone for the amazing information that we've had so far. I know I dropped off the call because I had a glitch, but I was wondering, one of the things that really drew me to Bloomfire was the user experience and how easy it was to use across a variety of specializations and skill sets within the organization. I was wondering how important that was and still is for you in curating an easy employee experience, as well as a beautiful way of calling out important information once you're searching that, and how that ties into the future that you envision for Bloomfire moving forward.
Yeah, no, I mean, I think you really hit on the critical piece, right? It's no matter what we're doing, the end user experience has to be positive. This can't be a solution that gets just pushed over into a corner where 10 people can use it and be really skillful with it, and the rest of us are just not able to access it. You know, we need to figure out, how do we bring forward all this technology in a very consumable way, so that regardless of how technically savvy you are, you can look at this solution and say, I understand how to leverage that, and I understand the value that's going to bring forward. So that's certainly our interfaces and the way that we try to allow people to approach this. But it's also what you can do inside of the platform. This isn't meant to just be a solution that I come to and passively access content. We have a number of different engagement opportunities allow people to be a part of this process. And we find that to be really impactful as well in increasing adoption rates and comfort levels. I can ask the clarifying questions. I can mention a colleague. I can add a comment. And I have all of these kinds of things that I'm used to. I'm doing this in my personal life and other areas. I'm just now bringing that forward and making that a practice as I access and gain new knowledge in the organization. So that is something that is really critical as we look at scaling this out and why we've taken the approach we have with things like generative AI. That can be scary to some people. They're not comfortable. You say the words prompt engineering and some people start to freeze. We're taking care of that, and we're just providing a very simple interface. Ask a question. We'll give you an answer. And if we don't have that, we're going to tell you. So I think that in that way, we've seen this be something that organizations have been excited about being able to approach, because they recognize, I can scale this across the org and everybody's going to get that value. It's not just that one pocket.
I'll just leave a final thought with you, right? Maybe from my other hat as a former customer as well. So, you know, from that experience, you kind of take away that not only is Bloomfire purpose built for information and knowledge management, you know, that's really focused on that user experience, but also the partnership approach that Bloomfire took with me as a customer kind of allowed us as a business to unlock proprietary knowledge that had been siloed through the company and start to bring it into the right hands at the right time. And what I really mean by that is Bloomfire has the technology to store and be the repository and have this great user experience, but it also becomes a bit of a rally point for executives and for CSRs or for, you know, insights and R&D people or whoever's using it, because they start to recognize, you know, in a much simpler way that having a data-driven culture means that you have to have this single source of truth for the enterprise. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that's, I think, seeing that transformation in action, I can just tell you that once it's implemented, it really becomes a powerful megaphone for knowledge as an asset for growth and a collaborative culture across a company.
Absolutely, I agree. Particularly with the future of work and remote work, hybrid work, all of these different situations. So thank you so much, Dan and Bobby, for those answers.
Well, Ryan, Dan, did you want to get enough?
I said our pleasure. We could talk all day, I'm sure.
It would not be difficult, but I just wanted to thank all of you for sharing your insights on behalf of Tish and myself. We really appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you so much
for having us.